Hello, Professor Vito.
Hello, how are you?
We're about to begin. Fine.
Good.
So, we're going to present you to the audience, okay?
Right.
Let me call the members of the table. Ranulfo, Beatriz, cadê Beatriz?
Hi, Professor. How are you?
I'm good. How are you, Ranulfo?
Okay, fine. Well, I'm talking in Portuguese. Introduce you to the people.
Okay. Of course.
O professor Peter Victor, ele atua atualmente na Universidade de York, Canadá. Ele é também um dos fundadores da parte de economia ecológica lá no referido país. E também foi membro durante tempos do Instituto de Nova Economia, né? E é uma satisfação poder estar interagindo com o professor. Já tivemos a oportunidade de estar trabalhando, vendo, discutindo alguns dos modelos de dinâmica de sistemas. Também vamos tentar trazer essa abordagem de dinâmica de sistema que ele vem trabalhando nos seus modelos, para analisar a economia brasileira. Então, sem mais delongas, deixo ao professor Peter Victor a palavra. Eu pensei que estava traduzindo. It's up to you, Professor.
Oh, it's over to me? Well, good morning, everyone. So I'm going to talk to you about ecological macroeconomics, which is a fairly new term, at least in the English language. In a way, it's a nice term for me because I think I've been working on something which I now can understand as ecological macroeconomics pretty much for my whole career. I'm sorry that I'm not there in person, but I still feel quite connected to you through the wonders of Skype and computer technology. So what I'm going to cover in the next, I think, 45 minutes or so is a brief description of what I understand by this term ecological macroeconomics, what the scope of the subject is, and then I'll outline some of the concepts, tools, and give examples with the results of that I find useful. And I gather from the introductory material I was sent that you want a discussion of the compatibility of an ecological macroeconomics approach with capitalism. I'm pretty confused about that myself, so I hope we can have a good discussion about that. So let me begin by describing ecological macroeconomics in the following way. This particular representation is supposed to represent mainstream economics, which focuses very much on the real economy, how labor and capital are used to produce goods and services, and money is not paid a lot of attention to, generally speaking. And you can see that from the way it's dealt with as a separate course in many universities, an elective for economic students, as opposed to being integrated in their studies. And of course, it also doesn't deal with the length of the real economy to the biosphere, which is really what ecological economics has emphasized for the last several decades. So most of the work on ecological economics to this day is about the dependency of the real economy on the biosphere, as illustrated in that particular graphic. But more recently, a lot of economists, including ecological economists, have come to realize that the real economy and how it behaves can't fully be appreciated without a proper analysis of the financial sector. And there's a body of work on this that coming under the heading Modern Money Theory, which I think does a really good job of explaining and analyzing the links between the financial sectors and the real economy. But that literature neglects the links to the biosphere. So a full-blown ecological macroeconomics tries to encompass all three of these integrated sectors. And it's of course, it's an ambitious agenda, and I don't know that anybody fully understands or appreciates all of these interconnections. I certainly don't, but at least it provides the terrain, the area in which we try to work. There's a very recent paper published by Hart and O'Neill in the journal Ecological Economics, which attempts to describe the wide range of modeling techniques that are used in ecological macroeconomics. And you'll see there on the far left the stock flow consistent title. That really refers to modern money theory and the way it's being integrated with these broader considerations, particularly of the links to the biosphere. There's the various kinds of input-output models in the center, both monetary and physical. And on the right-hand side, we have the system dynamics approach. And you can see the overlap among these various methods. So since I had a bit of a hand in the development of the input-output approach to understanding links with the biosphere, I thought that's where I would begin. So this term environmentally extended input-output analysis refers to the way in which the physical flows of materials and energy into an economy and the discharge of waste by the economy can be examined quantitatively by adding data to input-output tables and then really applying the basic methodology of input-output analysis with its rather, I would have to say, oversimplified assumptions about relationships, but nonetheless can produce some useful results. So the book that you see there was a book that I published in 1972, which was the write-up of my PhD dissertation on this very topic. But the big step forward, to my mind, that's happened since then comes about through the availability of world input-output tables as opposed to just national tables. And quite a few people are using these world tables, which basically show how the economic sectors in each country interact with the economic sectors of all other countries. And then you can attach to each of these sectors estimates of the material and energy flows that, of course, change as the economic interactions change. So myself and one of my PhD students, Brett Dalter, two or three years ago, used the World Input-Output Database matrices and produced, I think, some interesting results. We were asked to do this, by the way, by our Department of the Environment in Canada. I'll say a bit more about our work in a moment. I just wanted to show you a list of the countries for which are included in that particular World Input-Output Database. You'll see Brazil there, of course. I think there are about 40 countries plus the rest of the world as one sector. There are also other World Input-Output tables which are even more detailed, but this is a pretty good start and it was freely available, so we used that. So what we did, we looked at the greenhouse gas emissions using this method that are related to production that takes place in Canada. And this is the normal way in which the countries of the world tabulate their greenhouse gas emissions. And then we did a separate estimate of the greenhouse gas emissions that are embedded, if you like, in the consumption of Canadians. So what this means is that greenhouse gas emissions that are generated in Canada as a result of things that we produce for export are not counted as part of our consumption-based emissions. Those would be somebody else's consumption-based emissions. But likewise, when we import products from abroad, the greenhouse gas emissions that were produced when those products were manufactured become part of our consumption-based greenhouse gas emissions. And when we looked at the data, this is what we found, that starting in 1995, Canada's production-based emissions, in other words, including the emissions relating to our exports, but not those relating to our imports, exceeded our consumption-based emissions. But around 2006, there was an interesting switch when our consumption-based emissions started to exceed our own production-based emissions. And bearing in mind that Canada, of course, is well known as a natural resource producing economy, and this perhaps is came as a bit of a surprise, but it's all due to the change in trade patterns, or very much due to the change in trade patterns, where we're importing lots of products made in Japan, in China, and so on the consumption side, we are now counting the greenhouse gas emissions in China that were produced so that we could consume their products as part of the Canadian consumption base. So that's the blue line. And now you can do this analysis for all those countries in that world input output database, which we did do, and then you can compare the production-based estimates to the consumption-based estimates. With Canada, it's almost the same, beginning to widen towards the end of 2009. So here's a graph which shows that ratio of consumption-based to production-based emissions. And you'll see that
Just a moment, please. Can you share your screen?
You're not seeing my screen? I thought you were seeing my screen.
No.
You should have interrupted ages ago.
No problem.
Yes, of course. I've got to share the screen. Oh, wow. Shall I quickly go back to the beginning and show the slides that you've missed? Ranulfo, what would you have me do?
Okay, not yet.
Can you see the screen now?
No.
Hold it.
You can see, but not your presentation.
Right.
Yes.
Well, I'll go quickly back through this.
Can you put it in full screen, please? No. It stopped. We cannot see it.
You can't see it?
No.
That's strange. This worked when we practiced. So you can't see my screen?
No.
Right, bear with me a sec. So I'm on.
Okay.
Right. Now you can see yourselves, right?
Yeah.
Now what can you see?
Okay, now we can see your presentation, but no.
Can you see my slides now?
No.
Let me just try one other thing. I don't know what else I can do. So I'm doing that. I'm doing share screen. I start there. So what can you see now?
We can see the video, audience. The audience. No, your presentation. Okay.
It's okay now.
It's better. No, it's okay. No. No, we cannot see it. It's gone.
Now you can't see it?
No. We cannot see.
So when I go to the full slides, you can't see it. All right.
No. We can't. Can you put without the full screen, please? We try.
So what can you see now? You can see the slides now?
No.
This is so frustrating, isn't it, for everybody?
No problem.
I'm pressing share screen, and I start that.
Yeah.
But it's
now we can see the audience. And now we can see your presentation. Okay, let's go. Without full screen, please. In this way.
All right, so I showed you. Are you seeing just the slide, or are you seeing the little slides too?
Yeah, we can see the files. We can see. It's okay.
It's okay. All right. So I was explaining how ecological economics looks at the real economy in relation to the biosphere, and then I threw in the financial sector, and then I said ecological macroeconomics has to encompass all three. So the nice animations won't work, but that doesn't matter. And then I mentioned this study, recent paper, which looked at a range of different approaches to ecological macroeconomics. And then I was referring to this this book of mine. Maybe I can make this just a tad bigger. And then I showed this as an example of a world input-output table. I'm sorry, it must look very small to you, but maybe I'll make my slides available afterwards, and so everybody can then get copies that way. So I was at this point showing that the greenhouse gas emissions embedded in the consumption of the EU 27, that's the purple line at the top, is about 20-25% greater than the EU emissions coming out of that area. And then the same with the US, you can see that they are, if they were to be responsible for the emissions relating to their consumption, it would be about 20% higher than the emissions that come out of the United States. Canada, we're just about even at the moment. And of course, this has to be matched by what's going on in other countries. So the green line is the ratio of consumption to production-based emissions for the BRIC countries. So they're producing more emissions so that other people can consume products than they are for themselves. So this all comes out of this extended input-output analysis. And the next picture I'm going to show you, I thought it would be nice for you to see a winter picture in Canada, just so you can count your blessings for living in a nice warm part of the world. But this was about 6 weeks ago. We have a group of students from three universities studying ecological economics. And one of them, who's highlighted there, Alvaro Palazuelos, is a PhD student of mine from Argentina. And he used the same approach to look at water use in Brazil. So I thought I would show you those results. And in 2009, it turns out that Brazil is a net exporter of water. There's more water embedded in what you produce for yourselves and what you export than in what you consume, which would include the water embedded in the products produced abroad. That just shows how you can use this. And I've got another student, a Brazilian student actually, who's just last night sent me her estimates for greenhouse gas emissions for Brazil along the lines that I did for Canada. So moving now to systems dynamics, I don't know how well you can see this slide, but in the top right hand, or the right hand, upper right hand part of the slide, you see a traditional systems dynamics diagram. What it shows there is the rectangle in the middle and is a stock of, in this case, it's population. And population rises with an inflow of births and declines with an outflow of deaths. And the births, in this example, are determined by the birth rate, which would be a number of births per thousand, times the population. And then the same with deaths. And the great thing about system dynamics is that it allows you to examine these kinds of linkages that don't have to be linear. Feedback is easy, and you get a real insight into the way that whatever system you're modeling behaves. And it's interesting to me that this is not a methodology that is widely taught, at least in North America and Europe, to economic students. But those of us who are interested in linking the economy to the biosphere find this approach very useful. And very recently, we've been able to extend it to the financial system as well, as I will say later. But it's been around for some time. System dynamics was really virtually invented by Jay Forrester when he was working for General Electric. He was using it to understand how to improve the efficiency of their production plants. And in 1968, just by good luck, he spent some time at MIT, and he was placed in an office next to the former mayor of Boston. And they started talking about cities, and Forrester realized that his approach to modeling General Electric could be applied to cities, and he produced a book called Urban Dynamics in 1969. He then went on to produce World Dynamics in 71, but most people never heard of that book. What they have heard of, though, is the Limits to Growth book in 72, which is so similar to World Dynamics, it's really quite striking. Well, and it was produced by students of J. Forrester. Then, so it became very widely known, heavily criticized, but I think has stood the test of time pretty well. And then 92, the same authors of Limits to Growth did Beyond the Limits, and then in 2004, a further update. And this, these books all used systems dynamics to represent the world system with all sorts of interesting linkages and rather gloomy outlooks, unless some very significant interventions were made, which by and large haven't been done. Well, I stayed in touch with my own PhD supervisor over the years, although we lived thousands of kilometers apart on different sides of the country. But in about 2002, he contacted me, and there we are, he said he wanted to take up the question of growth that we discussed when I was his student about 30 years then beforehand. And so as of 2017, we produced a paper called Managing Without Growth, which included the first version of the simulation of model of the Canadian economy, which we put together in order to consider what might be accomplished if the economy wasn't growing, but not because it failed to grow, even though people wanted it to, but it was more the result of a thoughtful approach to slowing down growth and eliminating it and seeing what you could accomplish. So for that purpose, we built this model called LOGRO using the systems dynamic approach and addressed the question you can see there. Can we have full employment, no poverty, fiscal balance, in other words, taxes and revenue of government being more or less in balance, and reduce greenhouse gas emissions without relying on economic growth? Because the normal political discourse is that the best way to deal with unemployment is to grow the economy, to reduce poverty by growing the economy, to raise tax revenues by growing the economy, and to pay for greenhouse gas emission technology by growing the economy. So we were looking at really the alternative. In simple form, the model looks like this, with at the top we have macro demand in the normal way represented, GDP being the summation of consumption, investment, government expenditure, exports minus imports. And we have a gross aggregate production function for the economy. It's shown at the bottom. And so funds are spent, and that feeds into the requirements for output. But some of the funds, as you well know, that are spent in an economy are for investment, which expands the capital stock of the economy, meaning that you've got to keep increasing expenditure to keep the ever-expanding capital stock employed. And if at the same time population is growing and the labor force is growing, you further have to increase expenditure to keep the system from falling into unemployment. Well, the model calculates all of those relationships and estimates employment and capacity utilization. It keeps track of the fiscal position of the government. It keeps track of how many people are living below some defined poverty line, and it estimates greenhouse gas emissions and the performance of the forestry sector. And this is a very simplified version of the structure, but it gives you some idea of what it of how the model is structured. In the modeling language itself, the way it works is you get these sectors. So there's one for consumption, one for investment. I don't have to read them all out. Those are all very familiar to people who are used to analyzing the economy in those ways. So they're all there. There are some more sectors. On all of these, I'll show you in a sec, are interrelated. Here's some more. And there's the final set. And the interactions of these sectors is quite complex. And of course, you know, in your own mind, although you can be sensitive to these interactions, you really can't to work out how significant they are and what happens when you change something in one place to things in the other. And the idea of the system dynamics model is to make that all possible. So looking at what makes an economy grow, in simple terms, we can think of it in terms of macro demand, and we can also think of it in terms of macro supply. The more labor, the more capital, the more productive they are, and so on, will increase supply. And what the economy, in a way, tries to do is to keep these in balance in some way, and with a variety of monetary and fiscal policies of the government to make that work. So this isn't going to work very well. This is an animated slide. I'll have to take this off. When the model is projected forward based upon historical trends, and I have to say this, I'm talking about work that was done best part of a decade ago, so that's why it starts in 2005, and this is the Canadian economy. If we just project the trends of the previous 30 years into the future from 2005, you can see how GDP per capita is growing. That's the black line. Greenhouse gas emissions would grow. The unemployment rate would rise and then decline a bit. The government debt to GDP ratio would decline. But the poverty index, I use the UN's human poverty index, would increase over that period. So even with all that economic growth, we would have more people in Canada below the poverty line than before, largely because of the increase in population that was projected. But it's still not a very happy outcome when you think that the answer to poverty is more and more growth. The next thing I did was to just squeeze out all of the drivers of growth in the economy in a very sort of cavalier way. I just slowed them down until they were no longer active after 2020 to see what it would do to the economy. And I expected a disaster, and I wasn't disappointed. The unemployment rate just goes off the top of this graph. The government's debt to GDP ratio becomes completely untenable. The poverty rate goes way up. Eventually, there's no growth. The GDP per capita is stable, if you can look at the right-hand side of the graph. And greenhouse gas emissions have come down. But this is a very frightening scenario. Of course, a lot of human agony would be involved. So this is why governments don't want to see this happen. Most people don't either. The question is the only answer to avoiding this more growth, or can we find a better alternative? So around 2008, during the financial crisis, Larry Elliott, the economics editor of the Guardian newspaper, made that statement. The real issue is whether it's possible to challenge the growth at any cost model and come up with an alternative that is environmentally benign, economically robust, and politically feasible. So, here's a better scenario. Again, it's the result of changes introduced in 2010 progressively until 2020. And you can see that GDP per capita has now stabilized as a result of balanced trade, lower investment, and a stable population. Greenhouse gas emissions have come down as a result of a carbon price that's now active in the model. Unemployment has come down because of an assumed shorter work year. So on average, people are working fewer hours than they otherwise would have. The poverty index has come down a long way because of deliberate anti-poverty programs that are included in the model. And in addition to the things that I changed in the model, there are additional elements, I think, of a better scenario, and I've listed many of them there. The top one, I think, is really important. I do believe that we need to revise our meaning and measures of success. The idea of rising GDP is not what we should be looking at. And there's a huge literature, as I'm sure many of you know, critiquing GDP as an objective as a primary objective of government policy and government economic policy. But in addition, I think we need limits on materials, energy and waste and land use. We need, if we're going to have investment, to have much greener investment, more emphasis on local economies and less on global, more cooperation, less competition, and a financial system that serves the real economy. At the moment, I'm updating LOGRO. I thought I would just let you know some of the changes. Of course, the data's got to be updated, and the estimates of the various equations have to be revised. I'm making labor productivity endogenous. It wasn't before. I just assumed a rate of increase in labor productivity. The nice thing about this whole systems dynamic approach is it's not that difficult to change your mind about these things and to amend the model accordingly. The average work year is also endogenous now, so I don't assume a certain amount of time spent at work and then change it. The model changes it itself. I've changed the way I think of and have modeled business investment. There's now an explicit option for green investment to move funds out of conventional capacity expanding investment into investment that will be more effective for protecting the environment. I respond to some criticism I received that, well, you can still have growth as long as you grow the right sectors and not the others. I think that's a mistake, but the model now allows investigation of that. I'll be adding alternative measures of progress and additional environmental flows, not just greenhouse gases. And finally, integrating the financial sector through the stock flow consistency approach, which I'm now going to spend a few minutes explaining. So in the stock flow consistent macroeconomic world, you work with subsectors of the economy. The six I've got there are the six for which Canada produces balance sheets, and so it's very convenient to do it in that way. And the black lines that you see joining the sectors indicate the financial flows that go between them. And then you can see I've also added, as a part of ecological macroeconomics, the material and energy inflows to some of the sectors and the wastes that come from those sectors. So if you want to do stock flow consistent macroeconomics, what is it we're really talking about? Well, first of all, the obviously true statement that when funds are spent by one sector, say households, on another sector's output, such as non-financial firms, then the expenditure by households is the income of the firms. So you can start keeping track of that. As sectors accumulate financial assets, then other sectors must be accumulating financial liabilities. This is an important observation, that a financial asset is always matched by a financial liability somewhere in the economy or abroad, and so you keep track of that as well. And that the changes in the financial assets and liabilities of each sector have to be related to the financial flows between the sectors. So the contribution of stock flow consistent macroeconomics is to insist that the models keep a record of these balance sheets and flows. Just to show you how I'll come to that in a moment. So in the models, for each sector that you have a balance sheet. You have matrices that show the flow of funds among the sectors. You have to have some equations that link the stocks and flows of each sector. For every stock, there has to be flows in and flows out, just as I illustrated with population before, and that has to apply in the financial, real, and ecological components of the model. And then you need some behavioral equations that determine how these flows actually move, what drives them. So, for example, households have decisions about whether they want to consume or to save, and if they're going to save, do they invest in equities, do they put the money in the bank and buy government bonds, and so the models have to include some representation of those decisions. The business about the balancing can be illustrated as follows. Here's a graph with nothing on it to show Canada's net borrowing and lending for the years 1990 to 2016. And what I've done, and I'll show you in a moment, is I've separated the government from the private sector and non-residents. And here's what you find, is that when the government is in debt in the early part of this period, as you can see, then it's because the other sectors, taken as a whole, are in surplus. And there's an exact match, because one sector's liability has to be equal to another sector's assets, or one sector's borrowing is equal to all other sectors' lending. And you can see the mirror image that continues throughout that. And this is the sort of thing that shows up in a stock flow consistent model. And what myself and Tim Jackson, who I've done a lot of this work with, discovered is that it becomes a really good check on how coherent your model is, because if net borrowing and lending isn't zero throughout the economy, then it's because you've misrepresented some aspect in the model, and it's a great guide to where you need to go and fix things. So one of the papers we published, which has, attracted some attention by those who find this stuff interesting, is the question of whether a money system that's based upon credit in itself drives growth in the real economy. So what we did is we set up a stock flow consistent model, as all models, with some key simplifications. And we initially set it running at a steady state. But the money system in the model is, a reasonable representation of a credit-based system, so that money is created by the commercial banks when they extend loans to their borrowers, and on interest is paid on it. And we wanted to see whether the model would stay stable or what would happen to it. So here's how we went about it. I don't know if you can read that. It looks pretty small on my own screen. I hope it's better for you. But this shows the basis for where we could start from, with the simplest possible representation, with households on one side and firms on another, and the households consume and the firms pay them wages and profits, and you get money circulating around there. And the nice thing about this structure is automatically money that flows out of the households goes to the firms. So the model works beautifully in that way. Then we add in a government, we add in the rest of the world, and again we have financial flows linking them, and then finally the banking sector. And I do emphasize the word simplified at the top of this. There are many other linkages that one can think of, and in some other parts of our work we have gone a bit further than this. But for the purposes of the question at hand, whether a financial system, a money system based on credit, would destabilize a steady state economy, we thought this was enough. So when we run the model, these are some of the most boring diagrams you're ever likely to see, but here's GDP on an expenditure basis in a steady state. You can see consumption, government spending, gross investment. Here's GDP on an income basis, where we have wages and profits and depreciation and GDP. Everything is nice and stable. Here's the net worth of the sectors. Again, everything is in a steady state. Meanwhile, the banks are lending money. They're charging interest. The interest is being paid back to the banks. The banks are distributing the profit, which comes very much from the interest, to the shareholders. The shareholders use that as a form of income, and they spend, and the same amount of money just keeps circulating in this steady state economy. Then we said, well, what happens if the economy is growing and you move it to a steady state? So you can see in the first part of this graph, you've got some growth, and we squeeze, I forget exactly how we did that now. I think we just did it by having growing government expenditure to be the source of growth, and then we stopped that. Oh, dear. Sorry. And you see that the economy settles down. The money starts circulating at a constant rate, and the money supply stays constant. It's not a problem. We also shocked the net lending positions during that period. You can see how everything has to balance out, comes down to a steady state again. We also tried various ways of shocking the model, a big increase in consumption expenditure, but again, it didn't create an uncontrolled disturbance. It settled down into a steady state again. So the results that we achieved through this approach was that we couldn't show that there was a growth imperative arising from debt-based money. The stationary state was resilient to various demand shocks. The transition to a stationary state from growth was feasible under the conditions we assumed. The interest rate level didn't make a difference. The capacity adequacy or liquidity requirements that we specified didn't make a difference. However, it was possible to destabilize the model. So if, for example, you shock it and assume that the government responds with strict austerity, in other words, reducing its own expenditure because it's seen its tax revenues go down, then the model will collapse. It's not resilient to every possible intervention. Having said all that, I do want to emphasize that we were just looking at one element in a capitalist economy, and that's this interest payable on debt-based money, is to see whether it was a growth imperative. There are many other growth imperatives in capitalism, and I've put a list there. So this is not in any way to suggest that capitalism doesn't have growth as one of in many forms driving it. But we were focusing on the one particular issue, which I thought was a way of illustrating to you what can be done through stock flow consistent modeling and the use of system dynamics. I'm coming to a close now. I want to make clear two other things. First of all, I should have said this at the beginning. All of the work that I've been doing and describing to you is really directed at a developed country like Canada. I try to work with data as much as possible rather than just abstract theory. And so this is not a prescription for anybody else apart from the country that I happen to live in, though I think there are lessons that can be learned from this work by others. I just want to make that clear. And the second thing is that I'm not against growth. It's a question of growth in what? There are many things where all reasonable people would want to see growth, and I've listed a number of them there. But there's undesirable growth as well. And I haven't yet been able to persuade myself that we can avoid the undesirable growth, such as reduced material throughput, whilst we continue to expand GDP. It's possible to do it for a short while, but over the long term, I'm not talking about very long, the growth of the GDP quickly outpaces efficiency gains that you can get through various methods. So I do think there are some very strong implications for thinking about growth of GDP as a primary policy objective if we recognize there's undesirable growth that needs to be addressed. So finally, to close, I'm just going to outline some of the main components of a sustainable economy as Tim Jackson and I have thought about it. You have to have a view of enterprise. Enterprise is a broad term. We don't just say firms, because enterprise can take place in many kinds of organizations, and I think the increasing variety of organizations is something we have to look at. Enterprise is strongly related to employment. Employment and investment are very much related. We need a different pattern of employment. We need, I think, to resume the trend that existed in Canada up until about 1975, where Canadians on average were working less each year and benefiting from increased productivity through more leisure time. That trend pretty well halted in the mid-1970s. I think we need to bring that back. But at the same time, we need a different pattern of investment that doesn't simply add to productive capacity, putting more pressure on us to rely on expanded GDP to keep everybody employed and the capital equipment employed. That's why I'm interested in green investment. A lot of green investment doesn't give a financial return. So the question of how you finance it is a big one. And so that's a further link. And finally, there's the question of governance. Who gets to make the decisions? Who owns the capital? And so on. So we've written a lengthy paper on using this structure, which is available on the internet, called Green Economy at Community Scale, where we were asked to take our ideas about national economies and write about how it might work at a more local level, and that is available to you. Anyway, thank you for your attention. I'm so sorry that the slide presentation wasn't quite what I had intended, but I hope that you were able to see enough. And I will leave you with a thank you.